Counting down toward National Signing Day, Mark Rogers TV for the Smarts fan. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel right here for coverage with guys like Steve Hillwagon, who is the Big Ten senior writer at 247 Sports, and you can catch him on Bucknuts as well. Steve, how you doing today?
I'm doing great. Doing great.
All right. Counting down toward National Signing Day. We are just about 3 days away, and Ohio State and Georgia seem to be the two vying for the number one class in college football. But as we were talking about before we started to record, number one, number two, they're landing a load of talent and trying to add those extra pieces that could make it a really special class.
No question about it, Mark. And again, whether it's number one or number two when the dust clears on Wednesday afternoon or Wednesday night, it really doesn't make that big of a difference one way or the other. They're getting a ton of great players in this class already, with 12 in the national top 100, which is about as many as I can recall Ohio State having in a single class. And I know that they are still in the running for at least one more national top 100 player, with Nicholas Petit-Frere, a offensive lineman out of the state of Florida. So I could move to 13 if he decides to come to Ohio State. So, you know, I look at what Urban Meyer's track record has been in his time as the head coach at Ohio State, and he's had nothing but success in terms of recruiting. All of his classes have been in the top 10 since he arrived in 2012. And all but one of them have actually been in the top five. So this explains how you're able year in and year out to compete for championships and a berth in the playoff and so on, because of the talent that you're adding to the program year in and year out.
Yes, all the classes have been exceptional, and then they proved it on the field, some more than others. Of course, there's that famed 2013 class. This one seems to be even more special, more potentially, especially if some of these last guys get into the fold here, even over the top talented in regards to possibly the number one class, where Alabama has held that title for a number of years. Considering maybe the I don't want to see the negative feel around the program, because that's certainly not the case, but in terms of national perception and Ohio State maybe just being down a rung because Alabama's chosen by the committee and they missed out on the playoff and the Big Ten missed out on the playoff, and a lot was made of the Clemson loss the season before, and in that fashion affecting the perception, just not by the committee, but the kind of national media and the fans, just to have this sort of over-the-top class coming off the heels of just that down perception on Ohio State and the Big Ten.
Yeah, Mark, I think that this comes back to what Urban Meyer is able to do as a recruiter, how hard he works at it, how important it is to him. He was out on the road. He was cited in four or five different states, including seeing a player from Rhode Island this past week. So he was all over the map. Maryland, Florida, Michigan, all these different places, trying to wrap guys up and also look toward 2019 as well. So he is very demanding of his staff in terms of recruiting. And when you look at it, the results, as we said a moment ago, with one top five class after another, they never have a bad class at Ohio State. I think a lot of it comes back to Mark Pantoni, a guy who works kind of behind the scenes. He's not one of the 10 assistant coaches at Ohio State, but he is the recruiting coordinator, and he really kind of guides Coach Meyer and the assistants through the process hand in hand. They make the evaluations. He makes all of the provisions, so to speak, to make sure that all the I's are dotted, the T's are crossed. It's quite a machinery they have there at Ohio State in terms of recruiting. I think that's the lifeblood of any program. And you can say what you will about up, down, side to side. Generally, Ohio State's finished each season in the top five for Urban Meyer. And of course, beat USC, the Pac-12 champion, in the Cotton Bowl this past year. So, you know, they've been there 12 wins all but one season. under Urban Meyer, very few of the teams nationally can say that over that same 5 or 6 year period. So maybe Alabama could say it, but that's about it. So the Buckeyes kind of held their own. I agree. They won one national championship and probably had the team to win at least one more and in position to even do more than that. But I would agree. I think, you know, talk to Clemson. Why didn't they win it this year? I mean, it's any number of things kind of come into play.
Talking with Steve Hellwagon, got him on the line from 247 Sports. He is the Big Ten senior writer there. Also catch him on Bucknuts as well. I'm looking at the 247 outline on Nicholas Petit-Frere, the number one offensive tackle. That's according to every major service, the 247 composite as well. What's interesting here, and we're going to give one test to the Urban Meyer effect here, because according to the 14 predictors, Ohio State's not on the board right now, Steve, but with that final visit, Ohio State gets that final impression before National Signing Day for the number one offensive tackle. That would certainly be an amazing get coming in the back door there.
Yeah, Nicholas Petit-Frere, just an outstanding prospect from Tampa, Florida, Berkeley Prep School down there. Number 7 ranked player in the country, 6'6", 275 pounds. I think there is some sentiment that with that frame that he can add more weight, more bulk to his frame, obviously. And really, he's got the NFL prototype size already. It's just a matter of development, continuing to get better, continuing to get stronger, continuing to get quicker, all these other things. And for him to be number 7 in the country overall, that includes all positions right now in the 24/7 composite, really says a lot. I know that Florida, Notre Dame, Alabama, Ohio State, those are the four teams that really have kind of come to the forefront for Nicholas Petit-Frere. I think Notre Dame is probably, in a lot of people's mind, one of the teams to beat because he is very much in tune academically and wants to attend a school where he'll be challenged academically, not to say anything about any of the other three, but Notre Dame is outstanding school academically. Ohio State's getting kind of the last crack at the apple. They've got him visiting on an official visit this weekend to Ohio State. You know that Urban Meyer and his staff and the players that they have hosting Nicholas Petit-Frere will pull out all the stops to try and show him a great time on campus, the official visit process. They've got it down to a T, obviously, and showing the player the facilities, the campus, how they'll fit in. I'm sure he would work with the offensive line coach Greg Studrawa quite a bit about his positives, his negatives, and everything else with his game and how they could use him and how they could fit him in there. And then he's going to go back home, and he's going to have a tough decision over the next several days. Apparently, the way we understand it, he's going to announce at 10 a.m. on Wednesday as part of ESPN's coverage, live coverage from his school, presumably at 10 a.m. So we'll get the verdict for Nicholas Petit-Frere early on signing day. And then it'll be cause to either have a very long lunch and celebrate or go back to work and get back to work on what's going on for 2018.
So, yeah, Nicholas Petit-Frere with a difficult decision amongst a host of high-caliber programs looking at him. Rasheed Walker, another top-notch offensive tackle, number 3 rated, according to 247 Sports out of Maryland, seems to be making his decision a clear-cut one between Big Ten East rivals Ohio State and Penn State.
Yeah, it is a kind of a Big Ten powerhouse battle there. I think Virginia Tech was also involved with him at one point. He's the number 65 prospect in the country, and it would be definitely a coup for Ohio State to get him out of Maryland. Maryland has been a stronghold, I think, for Ohio State and Larry Johnson in recent years. Larry Johnson, the longtime assistant coach, for a while at Penn State, and then, of course, now at Ohio State. And he's been involved with this recruitment, even though he coaches the defensive line. They've had Greg Studrawa, the offensive line coach, and Urban Meyer. The three of them made an in-home visit with Rasheed Walker this past week. James Franklin also made an in-home visit for Penn State. And now the waiting game begins for Rasheed Walker. Where is he going to land on National Signing Day? I do not have an exact time or date yet for when he will plan to announce. But certainly that'll be one that Big Ten fans, Ohio State fans, Penn State fans will be looking, because he is a key piece, obviously, if the Buckeyes could land one of these two outstanding offensive tackles, either Rashid Walker or Nicholas Petit-Frere, it would be outstanding. The Buckeyes currently, Mark, only have two offensive linemen in this class, Matthew Jones and Max Ray. They took three offensive linemen last year with Thayer Munford, Josh Myers, and Wyatt Davis. So I think that they would really like to add another one to increase those numbers. And, of course, everybody knows they missed out on one of the top offensive linemen in the country, Jackson Carman from Fairfield, Ohio, down near Cincinnati. He picked Clemson for the original, or the early signing day back in December. So maybe to cushion that blow, if they could add Nicholas Petit-Frere or Rashid Walker here at the on the regular signing day or national signing day, however you want to put it, that would be a great coup, I think, for Ohio State.
If you look at any of the major boards, Ohio State has offered the elite players across the board, but obviously the interest varies per player. We mentioned off the top about four or five in play. Who else is really a serious candidate that we need to be following in the next 3 days?
Well, you've got a defensive end or a linebacker prospect, Javonte Jean-Baptiste. I don't know what it is with all these French names that they're involved with, but the French must be great at football, I suppose, from Bergen Catholic in New Jersey. He's the number 219 prospect nationally, Javonte Jean-Baptiste. I think Nebraska is shaping up as an important team in his recruitment. Ohio State is right there. He's on a visit this weekend to Texas A&M, and obviously Jimbo Fisher, the new head coach there, will try and sway him. Virginia Tech, Boston College, also involved for him. Urban Meyer and Greg Schiano were with him on Thursday for an in-home visit to try and make a late push for the Buckeyes. He'd be kind of an edge rusher type player, defensive end, outside linebacker. Ohio State plays the 4-3, so he would be a defensive end, probably in what they do. And they're trying to rebuild the depth there on the defensive line. They've already got five defensive linemen in this class for Ohio State, and he would be kind of the cherry on top if they're able to add him. But really, it sounds like it's he's Nebraska's to lose, and Texas A&M is making a push, and Ohio State is certainly staying right there with him. Another guy that the Buckeyes are kind of going back in on is an Ohio kid by the name of Tavion Thomas. He's a running back from Dayton Dunbar, a tough kid from a city school in Dayton, Ohio, just down the road about an hour or so from Columbus. And the issue with him, he was committed to Oklahoma. I'm not certain if there's some academic issues at play, whether he may attend a prep school and then attend his four-year college, or what the situation exactly is. But Ohio State has gone back in on him. He is visiting Ohio State, and I'm certain that during this two-day period when he's visiting Ohio State, they are laying out a plan for him to either graduate and enroll this year or graduate and go to a prep school for the fall or the following school year, and then come in to Ohio State probably in the winter or summer of 2019. So it remains to be seen kind of what's going on there. The depth at running back for Ohio State, they have two of them in this class, Brian Snead and Master Teague. They also have Mike Weber, as everybody knows, and J.K. Dobbins, outstanding tandem. Weber will be a junior, and Dobbins a sophomore, Antonio Williams a sophomore. And then you've also got DeMario McCall and Jalen Gill, who's in this class that could play either the running back or wide receiver position. So they've got some wide running backs, but they like Thomas a lot, and he is a guy who maybe could fit into this puzzle either 2018, 2019. He is decommitted from Oklahoma, so he's a free agent at this point. And I think most indications point that either 2018 or 2019, he will end up at Ohio State. It's just a matter of getting it worked out at this point.
Master Teague, if there's ever been a name of a star, if he comes through on the field, boy, there's going to be all sorts of nicknames and signs, and he's going to gain a following. I can about guarantee that.
Yeah, you know, the all-name team, this class is they've got a guy named LaChristian Smith, Blue Smith, the wide receiver from Huber Heights, Ohio. Here in Ohio, they've got Tommy Togiai. He is from Idaho, of all places, and he's coming to Ohio State. Tyler Friday, their man Friday, a defensive end. Taraja Mitchell, Kevon Pope, Seven Banks. That's a new one for me, a first name Seven, S-E-V-Y-N. But it's always kind of cool to USA Today used to publish, Mark, I'm sure you remember this, on the Thursday after signing day, somebody's job was tasked to type in all of those names of all the schools. I'm saying all 105 schools. They would publish the complete list of signees, and it was always kind of cool back in the day to go through those lists. I had a buddy that I worked with years ago at Buckeye Sports Bulletin. He'd go through and come up with his all-name team of guys who'd signed all over the country, and it was always kind of cool to go. I remember one of them that went on to great fame was Takeo Spikes, and we always said if he wasn't happy, he was going to Takeo his spikes and go home. So. Yeah, you see some different names here and there.
Yeah, Takeo took those spikes to the Auburn Tigers and then on to the NFL. He was a really good linebacker. This Jean-Baptiste kid, man, Steve, when you've been watching as much college football as we have for so many years, you lose track of names, and there's so many jumbled up in my head. I believe his father played at Nebraska. I tried to look it up, but I'm almost positive his father played at Nebraska.
That sounds right. I vaguely recall something along those lines. Of course, that would have been well before Nebraska joined the Big Ten, and I didn't follow it necessarily as closely as we do now. But, Nebraska looks like the team to beat, and that makes sense if it is a family connection there. And, of course, Scott Frost, a former Nebraska player, is now back in there as the head coach. And he was on staff briefly and also played there, obviously. So, he is going to try and reignite those family ties, you would think. And there are so many, you know, great Nebraska players, you know, from the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s, who will probably have kids coming through that program as they go forward.